In fact, from the first reading we had today, it tells us that God has forgiven us and requires us to forgive one another. But people refuse to forgive. Why? Because of wickedness. And in fact, I would love to talk about the wickedness of man today more than the forgiveness that is preached. Why? Because of the happiness in our time, by the way, in the States. Then it tells us that anger and wrath are abominations, and the sinful possess them. Anger, wrath, wickedness, they belong to the sinful man. That is why the sinful man harbors in his heart iniquity and wickedness, and he refuses to forgive his neighbor. The Lord says, however, forgive your neighbor the wrong that he has done, and then your sins will be pardoned when you pray. So if you don't forgive your neighbor, your sins will not be pardoned when you pray. So sometimes it is like fooling ourselves. Oh, we come before God, we pray every day, and we harbor iniquity and wickedness and unforgiveness in our hearts. We fool ourselves. When we speak, God does not hear us, because that is not the language he understands. God understands the language of forgiveness and requires each and every one of us to forgive. Every time, if I don't know the Bible, the same text I was thinking when we are told about forgiveness, we read about the parable of the servants who were debtors. One a debtor to his master, the other a debtor to the debtor himself. And every time we talk about this, as well as we talk about the prayer of our Father, also forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And whenever we explain in the church, we tend to prove or want to feel that we understand. But the moment we leave the church, we see harbor, enmity, and unforgiveness in our hearts. But today, the second reading tells us that even the life that we live is now, none of us lives for himself, says the Lord. If we live, he says, we live for the Lord. If we die, we die for the Lord. Therefore, whether we live or whether we die, we belong to the Lord. But how many of us do realize this? How many of us realize that the life we live ought to be the life of God? That you have life today is because God wants you to have life. And as you have this life, you are within God's vision, he sees you. And when you die, you still remain within the vision of God. But human beings cannot see. So whether you are alive, whether you are dead, God sees you. But the Lord tells us how we ought to live the life that you be well with us. Yet we refuse. We refuse because of our ignorance. Because we refuse because of our stupidity. Because of our foolishness. Yet we think that we are wise. Forgiveness is a command from the Lord. Because himself has set for us an example that we must follow. You see the king who forgave in the story we have today, who forgave his servants. It was not weakness. It was mercy. The king and the servant were not on the same level. Yet they were prophets, but they were not on the same level, status wise. The king is higher than the servant. The king could do away with the servant he wanted. But he decided to forgive the servant. He forgave all of them because he was a righteous king. He was a good person. He was a just man. He was a kind person. And above all, he was merciful. He showed mercy. So even in his greatness, he was magnanimous. He descended so low and said, okay, you go. Even in his greatness. When he ought to be proud, there are some of us, he would raise our shoulders. When he ought to put the man under his feet and put his leg in the back of his head, he descended so low and forgave him and said, you go. Because even though he was a king, he had a good heart. So good heart is not because you are rich or because you are poor. It is just who you are. We have people who have money, who are so proud, and who are so wicked. But here we have a king who was kind. A king who was merciful. A king who has so much, not just for himself, that if you allow and give away for people to borrow, somebody has someone who only as much as 10,000 talents. It was a lot of kindness. It was kindness in the first instance that led to his giving up that fund. It was kindness that led to his allowing someone who was like a riffraff to hold that money. He didn't ask for any guarantee. He didn't ask for a guarantor. He didn't ask for anything that could be seized when he had to pay. He allowed him to go his money, hoping that someday he would pay. So, and even though he could not pay, initially he said, I will do this to you when my bed forgives. So he was a kind person. Now, ordinarily speaking, you would have expected that this man who has been forgiven should learn something from the act of forgiveness that he has benefited from. Having been forgiven, you are expected that you not be an agent of forgiveness. You are expected that you going to preach what he benefited from. But this man turned out to be a wicked person. That's what he says. Wicked. And in fact, you will be surprised that the money that the young man got was even from the money that they had got him. But he was a wicked man. He refused to allow the forgiveness that he received from the bow, from the person who was hired, that he needed to send down to the fellow servants. That's why I said today, we want to look at this in some other light in the state. Because on Saturday's election in the state, when we are going to go out and vote, do you understand this? Yes. The wickedness of man will not allow the wicked to let the just and the justice of God to live. Many of those persons who have been blessed by God, who have enjoyed the privilege of God, God's mercy, kindness, abundance, will not allow the generality of the people to enjoy God's goodness, God's bounty, God's preference for the people. When you go out to manipulate elections, you are a wicked person. You are a very wicked soul. Because at those states, and indeed in the whole of Nigeria, we have been suffering under governments that have been irresponsible, that have been selfish, that have been self-centered, that have been egotistic, that have refused to take into consideration the affairs, the care and concerns of the ordinary man. And yet they come to us at the election and they deceive us. And the people who want to make their will known, wicked people who come and upturn the will of the people. If you participate in that act of wickedness, the Word of God says there is no forgiveness for the wicked man. Let me read it. I didn't even read it today. He says to the wicked man in the gospel reading today, he says, then the Lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked servant, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. And should you not have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his Lord delivered him to the jailers till you pay the last debt. So also my Father will do with every one of you who will not forgive. Anyone who is wicked, if in this election you buy PVC or you sell PVC, you are a wicked person. If in this election you collect money to vote and sell purchase, you are wicked. I'm serious. I'm not telling you who to vote for. I'm not telling you to vote for whoever you think that. If you sell your PVC, if you buy a PVC, if you impersonate, you are wicked. You know why you're wicked? Because you don't care about the future generations. My concern is not about you. My concern is about our children and our children's children and our children's children's children and our children's 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 children. Children's children. Children! That is my concern. My concern about you because you don't care about your life. And I'm telling you today, if you sell your PVC, you are wicked. And the cost there will be for you. If you buy a PVC, you are wicked. And the cost will be for you. If you have turned the will of the people, you go there, you read, you steal from the boss, you are wicked. That is what I can say. Just go, and the cost will be for you. Just go there, cast your vote on who you want to lead you. It's your right, and no one should change that. It's your right. If you vote, if your candidate wins, okay. If you don't win, okay. Let the people decide. Democracy is government of the people, for the people, and by the people. And that you are, by social contract, you are going to be as a country and as a state. And we're celebrating the home election to choose who we are government. If there are only 10 people in the state, one to choose, if 5 say this or 4 say this, let it be. Let us know who wins. Let it be that we put out the person and he is there. Whether he's good, whether he's bad, let it be only 4 years. Let it be. But when you go, you start collecting money. While you go, what do you pay? Don't say and don't give bribe. That is different between us and the other people in the global world. I know they have a way of electoral practices, but you can't just buy an educated man who is upright with money. How much and how much are they going to give you anyway? So I'm saying, don't do this just today. But I don't know what I can use. God has sent to you today. That as you go out, and you must come out. If you are one of those who are, you are not merciful. And I'm sure our leaders in this place are not merciful at all. They are not thinking about you. They are not thinking about your children. They are not thinking about families. They are not themselves. Themselves and themselves. That was the part of the wicked man, the wicked servants. He was thinking about himself. Himself and himself. He went to the king, it was for himself. He went to the fellow servant, it was for himself. When he did everything for other people, you must have the consideration of other people, the concern. If you don't have the concern of people, you cannot do anything. So if I accept this way of yourself, you will never ever do anything good in life. And none of us believes for himself only, none of us dies for himself only. If we live, we live for. So, what is it for you? So, Paul says that's not for you. The life we live is not for you. It is for God. He says to us today in the second reading, none of us live to himself, and none of us dies to himself. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that may be the Lord, both of the living and of the dead. So, you are just to be your Lord, whether you are alive or whether you are dead, live the life of Christ. Live the life of Christ. It is not only here, there is life after here. So, you don't understand. So, once again, dear brother and sister, I charge you, and I will say all of this to you. In my sermon, I will say all this to you. I will remind you of you, and those things, citizens, indigenous of the state, those carrying members, previously holders, that whatever it is that you do, the Lord Jesus is watching you. And we must remember that our children, they have destinies.